Seven Secrets of the Goddess by Devdutt Pattanaik. Chapter 6, Saraswati's Secret. Imagination can expand or contract the mind. Part 1. Experts on the Vedas often say how the Saraswati has dried up. No one is sure what this means exactly. Does this refer to a river that flowed 4,000 years ago in Punjab, Sindh and Rajasthan, on whose banks many of the hymns of the Rig Veda came to be composed? Or does it refer to the metaphorical river of language and imagination that is used more to control the world rather than break free from fear? No one is sure. Different scholars approach Vedic verses differently, either literally or symbolically. In the Purans, Saraswati is a well-defined goddess. Her stories are rare, though always related to language. The Devas, for example, invoke her just when the demon Kumbhakarna is about to ask Brahma for a boon and request her to twist the Rakshasa's tongue so that instead of Indra Asan, seat of Indra, he asks for Nidra Asan, sleep. In these Purans, Saraswati is identified as the first creation of Brahma, even the first woman created by Brahma. Brahma gets infatuated with her. Such incestuous affection is frowned upon, and Rudra Shiva, who embodies renunciation, either beheads Brahma or simply pins him to the sky to stop him from pursuing her. Like Vedic hymns, this Puranic story can be seen literally or symbolically. Symbolically, it refers to the tension between a creator claiming ownership over his creation and the renouncer destroying this relationship and advocating detachment. The daughter is sometimes called Shatarupa, she of many forms. When Brahma steps back and observes his creation, not with the desire to control it, but from the desire to understand it, he realizes it reflects his own mind. His creation is a mirror that reflects his own personality. Shatarupa then becomes his teacher, Saraswati, she who flows in the mind. Some sociologists are of the opinion that the absence of Brahma temples in later Hinduism was a symbolic rejection of the old Vedic way that was highly materialistic. The rise of Vishnu and Shiva temples marks a shift in thought in Hinduism. In the Purans, Saraswati, who shuns the vile Brahma, becomes consort of Vishnu, according to Vaishnavas, the companion of Ganesha, according to Shaivas, and the daughter of Shakti, according to Shaktas. In the new form of Hinduism, where answers were sought in temples beyond materialism, but always through materialism, the all-male triad of Brahma, Vishnu and Shiva was replaced by the triad of Devi, Vishnu and Shiva. While Shiva is commonly paired with Shakti, who is Durga or Kali or Gauri, and Vishnu is paired with Lakshmi, it is not clear who Saraswati should be paired with. To maintain symmetry between the male triad, Shiva, Vishnu, Brahma, and the female triad, Durga, Lakshmi, Saraswati, it is common to link Brahma with Saraswati. The explanation given for this is that the creator needs knowledge, the sustainer needs wealth, and the destroyer needs power. This is a more convenient explanation than an accurate one, for everyone knows that all three resources are needed for all three jobs. To assume that you can create with knowledge alone, without wealth and power, or you can sustain only with wealth, without knowledge or power, is fantastic to say the least. In medieval times, it was common to show Lakshmi and Saraswati as the two consorts of Vishnu and Shakti as his sister. The rival sect of Shiva worshippers also appropriated Lakshmi and Saraswati by placing them on either side of Ganesha, Shiva's more worldly son. As Ganesha's consorts, they are more popular known as Riddhi, goddess of material treasures, and Siddhi, goddess of mental powers. In Bengal, Lakshmi is associated with the food-loving Ganesha, who is associated with learned Brahmins, and Saraswati with the art-loving Kartikeya, associated with affluent landowners or zamindars. Despite being linked to Brahma, Vishnu, Ganesha and Kartikeya, images of Saraswati with a male consort are rare. She is shown as aloof and distant, always alone, content in her own company, an indicator of true wisdom. Unlike other goddesses who turn hot and fiery and dangerous when kept away from matrimony and maternity, Saraswati remains calm and composed despite her isolation. A cynic may equate Saraswati's white sari not with ascetism but with widowhood, revealing the loneliness of women especially, but also men who are extremely intelligent or intellectual or smart. Saraswati, like Lakshmi, is essentially an independent goddess. Her origins can be traced to the 4,000-year-old Rig Samhita. There, she shares her name with the river Saraswati and her qualities with Vak, goddess of speech, language and meaning. She is sometimes also linked to Gayatri, the goddess of Vedic hymns and melodies. The Vedas paid great attention to language. Language was at one time called Brahman, which etymologically means that which expands, Bra in Sanskrit, the mind, Manas. Later, the word Brahman came to mean divinity. Language is the one thing that distinguishes humans from other animals. Animals communicate with each other, but they are just signals. Human language is more complex, allowing people to explore and express abstract concepts, intangible ideas such as past, present, beyond, love, and friendship. Language can be expressed using gestures, mudras, using speech, vak, and of course, script. The vowels or matras were associated with goddesses, the matrikas. And early Indian scripts, Brahmi and Sharada, were both personified as women and goddesses. Brahmi was the daughter of the Jain Tirthankara, Rishabh, to whom he bequeathed the first script. Sharada became another form of Saraswati and Vak, who was especially worshipped by Adi Shankara, the great 8th century Vedanta scholar, who probably read works of earlier philosophers in the Sharada script. Language emerges from imagination, and it also expands imagination. Imagination is the one thing that animals do not have, at least not on the scale of humans. Imagination is fluid, Saras, and can either be contained as a lake, Sarovar, or made to flow like a river, Sarita. From Saras comes Saraswati. Imagination allows humans to travel through space without moving and through time in a single moment. Imagination allows humans to conjure up worlds that do not exist. Humans communicate these thoughts through language. Saraswati is the goddess of fluid thoughts and words, an exclusively human goddess who grants humanity to humans. Perhaps that is why Hindus paint their forehead with sacred marks, for the head contains the brain, the home of Saraswati. A dot, or the bindu, in the center of the forehead is an indicator of human potential, our ability to make sense of the world and solve any of its problems. Because Saraswati enables us to understand and appreciate nature, she eventually becomes the goddess of arts, associated with literature and music, and holds in her hands a book and a lute, Veena in Sanskrit. She is even called Veda Mata, the mother of the Vedas. She is also the mother of Swaras, musical notes, and Ragas, melodies. In imagery, Saraswati is often associated with a goose, Hamsa, because legend has it that a goose can separate milk from a mixture of milk and water. In other words, it can separate truth, milk, from falsehood, water, making it the symbol of analysis. Saraswati is also associated with the heron, which is the symbol of concentration. And in modern calendar art, with a peacock, which does not spread its feathers in her presence, as it knows that humility is the true measure of wisdom. She is associated with white and transparent things to indicate her purity. She is associated with white champa flowers and the white autumn moon and white transparent crystal beads. She is often invoked during Vasant or springtime because the season of spring inspires poets to compose songs. In this month, she is dressed in bright yellow clothes, the color of mustard flowers. Chapter 6. Saraswati's Secret. Imagination can expand or contract the mind. Part 2.
Chapter 7. Brahma's Secret. Human life is an opportunity. Part 1.